Hi, this is Lindsay, one of the co-hosts of Beauties and Headcanons. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media.
This is John Lauder, host of The Cheap Seats here on Public House Media. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media. Once you're done with this episode, I hope you'll come check out my show, The Cheap Seats, where we talk about sports from the fans' perspective. A new show comes out every Monday. Don't forget to subscribe on iTunes so you never miss an episode of The Cheap Seats. Thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
The latest headlines.
The Houston Astros, the defending World Series champions, got better, adding Garrett Cole.
The insightful interviews.
Rick Saratella, NFL Draft Bible. With how much emphasis is put on the position, yet how many over the last couple of years we've had questions. Why do we put such an emphasis on drafting a quarterback number one overall?
The bottom line is there's not enough good quarterbacks to go around. And I think with the new CBA, it's really a low-risk gamble now. If you look at the playoff teams, the common denominator, good quarterback play.
The hottest takes.
I think the guy to blame is the one guy who hasn't left yet. I think Russell Westbrook is one of the bigger problems in Oklahoma City.
Can all be found on Press Row.
Broadcasting is part of the Public House Media Network.
Here's your host.
It doesn't matter what your name is.
Christian Heimel.
What is up, everybody? Welcome once again on Press Row. Here broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network. Don't forget you can subscribe, rate, review, share us with your friends and family. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts, Spotify, Google, and Apple Podcasts, and of course, Spreaker.com and publichousemedia.org. We'll get to your listener questions in a little bit, as we do every single week. You can always submit those shows throughout the week. Find us on Twitter and Instagram at PressRowPHM. You can email the show, PressRowPHM@gmail.com. Or you can find us on Facebook, Press Row by Public House Media. I'm Christian Heimel. You can always find me on Twitter as well, at Chris Heimel, C-H-R-I-S-H-E-I-M-A-L-L. There is a lot to get to this week in sports. We'll talk about conference championship weekend coming up in just a little bit. We'll get to some of your listener questions, of course, as well. But I want to start, you know, as you guys know and listen to the show, I mean, for lack of a better term, this is a baseball podcast because we talk about it every chance we get. And Kyler Murray's decision to enter the NFL draft and what his potential future could be with the Oakland Athletics. Look, this is what's really, really important to note. This is a pure monetary decision. And first off, entering the NFL draft was a procedural move. He had to do that on Monday if he was going to even consider football as a future, at least for this year. He did it. It doesn't mean that he's giving up on baseball. Now, listen, there have been plenty of people. Friend of the show, Mike Leslie, WFAA in Dallas, has made mention that there's been a monetary, not demand, but at least a starting point as to what it would take. But listen, here's the thing with Kyler Murray. And it's the right move for him. Absolutely. Now, is football a more dangerous sport? 100% it is more dangerous. But more importantly with football is it is the best financial move for him. This is a Heisman Trophy winner who went to the college football playoff and had a shot at a national championship. Granted, they struggled against Oklahoma, but this is a kid who is so talented at the quarterback position that he has been talked about as a number one overall pick. Why wouldn't you choose football? When you look at the money, yes, it's a $4.66 million signing bonus. But take this from someone who has worked in minor league baseball for the better part of his career. He would spend 2, maybe 3 years in the minor league system making $2,500 bucks a month for 5 months out of the year. He's making less than 30 grand a year if he tries to play baseball. Yes, he does have that big giant signing bonus, but if he decides to go into the NFL and he's drafted in the first round, he gets a 5-year contract worth almost $20 million total. Why wouldn't you take that? Your career's not going to be as long in football. No, that's a given. But it would take so much longer for him to make the kind of money that he would in football in baseball. There was a great stat or a great note. There are, if I believe, three NFL quarterbacks that are making at least $300 million in their lifetime from a contract. There are zero active MLB players who currently have earned $300 million. Now, I know Giancarlo and Harper's eventual contract and all that stuff, but there have yet to be a single active Major League Baseball player to earn over $300 million in their career, active. Meanwhile, in the NFL, there are three active quarterbacks who have made that amount of money already. His chances, Kirk D. Cousins just got $100 million guaranteed by the Minnesota Vikings. Your rookie contract is more guaranteed in football than it is in baseball. And it's a smaller salary, yes, but it's a better salary than what he would be getting in minor league baseball. And I'll be 100% honest. Look, I think Kyler Murray is incredibly talented. I think he's a freak athlete. What I don't know is how his talent translates to the next level. There's a big problem with trying to decide and translate and project baseball players. I've seen a lot of scouting reports. I've seen a lot of people talk about Kyler Murray in the same vein as Mike Trout, that kind of athleticism. He doesn't have a great arm, surprisingly. He doesn't have a great arm as an outfielder. He's got a decent slash line. You know, at Oklahoma last year, prior to getting drafted with the ninth overall pick, he was a .298 hitter. He had a couple of stolen bases, a couple of home runs. He's got good speed. He could eventually get to there. We know what he can do in football already. We know that. The A's made a gamble, giving him nearly $5 million as a signing bonus that he would have to give back if he chose to forego a baseball career. But he'd make that back the second his name is called by Roger Goodell in the NFL draft, and then some, because of a signing bonus, because of the endorsement deals he would get. And this is what I have been saying. It's not just that there's more money in football from a contract standpoint. There's more money in football from a marketing standpoint. This has been one of the biggest issues in Major League Baseball's history, is that they do not know how to market their players. Think about it. How many Major League... You went to a random kid in the middle of... I don't know. Like, pick some random kid in Arizona. And how many baseball players do you think he recognizes before you get to Kyler Murray? Current baseball players. Mike Trout, Bryce Harper, Aaron Judge, Giancarlo Stanton, maybe Mookie Betts, who is the MVP. Most certainly not Christian Yelich, who is the NL MVP. Maybe Paul Goldschmidt because he's in Arizona. But you ask him who's more famous, any of those baseball players or Kyler Murray, he'll tell you Kyler Murray. He will. Because that's what Major League Baseball's problem is. If Major League Baseball wants freak athletes, two-sport players like Kyler Murray to stay and play baseball for their future, there's only one way to do it. Get better at marketing your stars. NFL, NBA, even the NHL, hell, the PGA Tour, all do a better job of marketing their stars on the national level than Major League Baseball does. I have said this many a time on this show. I love Red Sox Yankees. I'm a Red Sox fan. I love it. I don't need to see it on prime time every single time. I'd rather see Mike Trout against Bryce Harper. I would rather see Nolan Arenado and the Colorado Rockies against, I don't know, Paul Goldschmidt and the Arizona Diamondbacks. I would much rather see that. But Major League Baseball and its TV partners would rather chase Red Sox Yankees like a dog chasing an ice cream truck. They have no idea what they're going to do with it if they catch it. No idea what happens if they catch lightning in a bottle, like they did this past year. They had no idea, because you know what? Very few people outside of New York or Boston tune into those, because we are saturated with it. We are over it. Andrew Benintendi, Mookie Betts, Aaron Judge, Gleyber Torres, Greg Bird, Luke Voigt. There are so many talented players on both of those teams. We don't care because we see it all the time. There will be many more Kyler Murrays down the road. Every single one of them will go and play in the NFL unless Major League Baseball figures out a better way to market its athletes. And Rob Manfred is a problem because of it. Think about what he said about Mike Trout this past year. We have given Mike the opportunities he needs to market himself as well. No! You are the only sport outside of the NBA where your players are that visible. Their face, their actual facial features are that visible while they're playing. The NBA is the only sport where your athletes have more visibility. And yet, I'm willing to bet if you put 10 athletes and only one baseball player, one of them is a baseball player, and ask someone to tell me who's the most famous one, that baseball player is probably in the bottom three, 8, 9, or 10. Because Major League Baseball does a terrible job at marketing its stars. This isn't a monetary, at its basis, maybe it's a monetary issue. But when it comes, really comes down to it, this is an issue because Kyler Murray knows I may end up making more money in Major League Baseball because there's no salary cap. And we're going to see stupid contracts for Bryce Harper and Manny Machado. But I can make so much more marketing myself with endorsement deals and being marketed by the NFL with jersey sales than I would in Major League Baseball. And I can't fault Kyler for it. I absolutely can't. When we come back, we'll take a look at conference championship weekend in the NFL. Patriots, Chiefs, Rams, and Saints. It's all coming up. Your listener questions as well. You're on Press Row, broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network.
Want to be part of the show? Go to Facebook and search Press Row Podcast Public House Media. Or find us on Twitter and Instagram at Press Row PHM. You can also email the program, PressRowPHM@gmail.com.
This is Bryce Burge, host of Your Soccer Passport here on Public House Media. After this episode, come join us on a trip around the soccer world as we discuss club and country every Tuesday. Stamp Your Soccer Passport by subscribing on Spotify, iTunes, or wherever you get your Public House Media podcasts. And thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
This is Press Row with Christian Heimel, a Public House Media podcast.
Early in the morning, rising to the street. Light me up that cigarette, I'll strap shoes on my feet.
Back on Press Row, Christian Heimel with you. Broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network. As always, don't forget to subscribe, rate, review, share us with your friends and family. Continue to make us one of the fastest growing sports podcasts in the country. Last week was one of our best shows of our history, our sixth highest rated show of all time. Big thanks to Brandon Robinson, Scoop B Radio, for joining us on the program last week. For you guys to listening and sharing it with everybody. So we really do appreciate that. Want to get to a couple of things. You can always, of course, find our podcast wherever you get your podcast enjoyment. Spotify, Apple, and Google Podcasts. We're also on Spreaker.com. And, of course, publichousemedia.org. Conference championship weekend coming up, the final four for football. And it's impressive to note. I said this last week. You look at the teams that run the football and control the line of scrimmage are going to be the ones that win the game. Now, I told you to watch out for the Colts as a potential upset. Didn't happen. I said it with the Chargers because I felt they had a better defense than the Patriots, and that with their running game, Melvin Gordon, Austin Eckler, they could have done something there. But when you really look at it, I wasn't wrong. The four teams that won this past weekend were the four teams that ran the ball the best. The Los Angeles Rams had 200-yard rushers in Gurley and C.J. Anderson. That's just the fourth time in playoff history that two teammates have rushed for over 100 yards in the same postseason game. They go on and they beat, the Cowboys there and advance into the semifinals essentially. The Saints even ran the ball. They weren't the best running team, but they ran the ball better than the Eagles, and their defense was dominant in the second half after falling behind 14-0 in the first quarter. And the Saints go marching on. The Patriots, that was the best defensive performance I have seen from New England in probably 4 years. It was incredible. They shut down Phillip Rivers. They absolutely plugged up the running game of Melvin Gordon and Austin Eckler. They were dominant at home. Of course, helps that the, you know, Chargers defense was atrocious and played zone coverage against the greatest quarterback of all time. You can't play zone against Tom Brady and expect to win. You just can't do it. It's not physically possible. And then, of course, you had the Chiefs, who with Damian Williams still found a way to run the ball. How impressive is it that Pat Mahomes, Jared Goff, didn't throw a single touchdown pass? How is that? How? That's the running game, and they dominated. Pat Mahomes and the Chiefs had four rushing touchdowns. They were dominant in that game because they ran the football. And that's what it's going to take coming up this weekend for these four teams, whichever one's going to advance to the Super Bowl. It's about controlling the clock. And I think what Bill Belichick did was brilliant. It's very rare that the Patriots take the ball first. They usually defer to the second half. But what they sent a message, not only to the Chargers, but to whoever came out of that Indianapolis and Kansas City game. They sent a message that said, you know what? We're still the Patriots. We're still the dynasty. We're still the standard in the NFL. And they got the ball and they marched down the field on a 9-minute drive. And then they went on to do it three more times in a row. That was a statement to the rest of the league that, hey, we may not have had the best regular season, but it's still Tom Brady and it's still Bill Belichick. So you better watch out. Saints did something similar. I mean, they struggled right off the start, and then they go on an 11-minute drive. And they prove that in that building, they are untouchable. Untouchable. It's going to be a lot of fun this weekend to watch these four teams because as much as they ran the ball and as much as they played great defense, these are the four highest scoring teams in the NFL. It's the first time that's ever happened that the four highest scoring offenses all make it to conference championship weekend. But it's going to come down to which team plays the best defense and which team can run the football and control the tempo. And this is why if anybody's going to beat the Patriots, it's going to be the Kansas City Chiefs. What? Look at what they did to Andrew Luck. Andrew Luck is cut from the same cloth as Tom Brady. No, he's not as good, but he picks you apart in zone. He doesn't move in the pocket much. He needs protection to be able to dominate. And if you give him space in zone coverage, it works. But the Chiefs play a lot of man defense. They pressure the receivers. They don't give a lot of space for Brady to nickel and dime him down the field and then go for the deep pass. And they also rush the quarterback well. Justin Houston's great at it. Great at it. Now, that being said, the part about this that makes it interesting and makes it fun and the reason why, even though the Patriots might be underdogs on the road, they're still not going to be surprising anybody if they win. You go down the list. Who would you rather? Bill Belichick or Andy Reid? Belichick. Brady or Mahomes? Brady. Edelman or Tyreek Hill? Edelman. Would you rather Sony Michel or Damian Williams? Maybe a toss-up. Sony Michel's played well this year. He's played great this year. James White or, you know, Sammy Watkins? Probably James White. Even though it's not fair because White's also a running back and Watkins isn't. Travis Kelce or Rob Gronkowski? That one might be a toss-up. You might go Kelce in that one. More often than not, though, when you break it down, you're going with the Patriots. And then flip things over to the Rams and the Saints. Number one, number two, it's in New Orleans. Jared Goff or Drew Brees, who you got? I'm taking Drew Brees. I'm taking that incredible defense, Marshawn Lattimore, Cam Jordan up front. The Saints are quality. There's a reason I picked them at the beginning of the year to win the Super Bowl. So it's going to be a lot of fun. I do think that the higher scoring game is the NFC one just because it's indoors. I don't know what the elements are going to be like in Kansas City, but I would assume that they have some impact on the game. But that being said, you cannot count out the greatest of all time in Brady and Belichick. It'll be a fun game. Don't get me wrong. It'll be a really enjoyable game. But when it all comes down to it and it's Saints, Patriots in the Super Bowl, nobody's going to be shocked. Absolutely nobody. All right, get to your listener questions when we come back. Wrap things up here on this Thursday here, January 17th, 2019. You're on Press Row, broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network.
Listen to every episode and get the latest shows sent right to you. Subscribe to Press Row on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spreaker.com, and Stitcher.com. Or visit us online at www.thephmedia.com.
Hey everyone, I'm Matt Coyne.
And I'm Jake Holmes.
We host the Friday edition of The Cheap Seats, presented by Squadcast.fm. Make sure you join us every week because we're going to be recapping the biggest headlines from the past week in sports, as well as preview the upcoming weekend so that you know what to talk about, what to expect at your tailgate and viewing parties.
Yeah, and don't forget to vote on our poll question on Facebook at The Cheap Seats by Public House Media. And please subscribe to The Cheap Seat on Apple and Google Podcasts, as well as Spotify and more, so you never miss an episode.
Yeah, a new episode, it comes out every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, but you can only catch the C-Team with Jake Holmes and Matt Coyne here on Fridays, way up here in the cheap seats, presented by Squadcast.fm here on Public House Media.
This is Press Row with Christian Heimel, a Public House Media podcast.
Wrap up shop as we do here every single week on Press Row with your listener questions. Christian Heimel here with you. You can submit those questions all week long on social media. Find us on Twitter and Instagram at PressRowPHM. You can email the show, PressRowPHM@gmail.com, or find us on Facebook, Press Row by Public House Media. We'll start off, Brandon in Alaska wants to know, the Maori Davenport story, is this the last that we've heard of it, and has the right decision been made? So for those of you who don't know, this is a story that is insane. Maori Davenport is the 15th ranked high school women's or girls basketball player in the country. She's already committed to go play college ball at Rutgers. She's a member of Team USA on the U18 squad, and she had been suspended for her entire senior year because of improper benefits, quote unquote. Those improper benefits were when she was traveling with Team USA, she received too much per diem or too much travel money, whatever it is. She recognized it, paid it back. And even though Team USA said, okay, cool, fine, nothing wrong, we're good, we're fine, the state of Alabama decided to suspend her for the entire year. Now, fortunately, a judge has since, placed an injunction on that suspension. She can play. She's a phenomenal talent. And this is where we have issues. This is where the problem becomes with all of this corruption in basketball. It's not the kids that are making these problems. It's the adults. The adults are not acting like adults. Say what you want, but every single issue, when it comes down to AAU or youth basketball, is because of adults. This is a kid in Mayori Davenport who, and her parents, who recognized the issue, corrected the issue, paid back the money. And Team USA said, cool, we're good, awesome, thank you, we're fine, no problem, no harm, no foul. And yet adults look to nitpick to punish a child for adults' mistakes. It's unfathomable to me that we do this, that we allow this stuff to happen. When you look back at the Fab Five at Michigan and Chris Webber, Jalen Rose, Ray King, and those guys, and the issues and the reasons why their Final Four banners were revoked and taken away because of improper benefits, they're kids. I understand they're 18, 19 years old. They're considered adults. But these are kids expected to make adult decisions. And it's because of adults making poor decisions for these kids that we have these issues. Look at Cam Newton. He made certain decisions, yes, that were wrong. Stealing laptops from Florida, which is why he had to transfer down to a junior college. His dad using a whole pay-for-play scheme, whether it was true or not. That's his father making an adult, making a bad decision that is punishing the kid. That's our problem with these youth sports. It's not the kids making bad decisions, it's the adults making bad decisions. That, therefore, only punish the kids. They don't punish the adults at any point. They don't do that. It's ridiculous that that happens. So I hope that with Mayori Davenport, to get back to your question, Brandon, I hope that this decision is what becomes. I hope that the suspension is fully revoked, that Mayori Davenport can continue to play out her senior year, that she loses zero eligibility to the NCAA, and she can go on to have a great career, not only at Rutgers, but in the WNBA as well, because she is a very good talent. And that it's insane that poor decisions by adults negatively impact kids when the kid did nothing wrong. Absolutely nothing wrong. All right, Michael in Chicago. The White Sox offered Manny Machado 7 years, $175 million. How likely is it that he signs? I'll be honest, I don't think he goes there. I think there will be another team that offers more money, maybe the same amount of years, but I do think that there will be a team, whether it's the Phillies, whether it's this mystery team, whatever it is, I do think there is another team out there that will give Manny a $200 million plus deal. And I think he will end up taking that. Do I think he should go to Chicago? Absolutely. But I think he should go to the Cubs. I've been saying that for a while, whether the Cubs are interested or not. You put him in that lineup with Anthony Rizzo, Chris Bryant, Javi Baez, Contreras. That's a sick line. That's scary good there. I mean, maybe he even goes to the Cardinals. Who knows? But that it's really surprising to me that the White Sox are this all in on Manny Machado, knowing that they do have a lot of youth. And maybe that's what it is. They want to bring in a veteran presence to match with Jose Abreu and Yoan Moncada and some of the guys that they have there. So if it works out, I think it's great for Chicago. But I really do think there's another team involved that may have a better shot than the White Sox there. So. Last one here, and then we'll wrap up shop in just a little bit. Tyler asking, with Syracuse beating Duke, but without Cam Reddish, is it really a victory? Does it really show that the Blue Devils are struggling? Yes and no. Look, that win on the road, it's the first time ever that Duke, when they were ranked number one, lost at home to an unranked team. But this goes to show you just how difficult it is to game plan. The 2-3 zone's been around for generations in basketball, but it is so difficult to really break down and beat when you're not at your best. Cam Reddish out with an injury, out with a illness, obviously hurt. The point guard Jones got injured early on, so they were basically down two starters 5 minutes into the game. I don't think you can bank on the fact of Duke struggling like that again, especially at home. But what this does show to me is it does show that there are chinks in that armor. There are weaknesses with Duke basketball because when they face adversity with this young a crew, how will it impact? that's what made the Fab Five so special, is that they were all freshmen, that it didn't matter. The adversity didn't bother them. We look at Kentucky all the time, and when they won the national title a few years ago, it was impressive because these are all, they're 17, 18-year-old kids that are doing this. First time they're really facing adversity. So I'll be interested to see what happens as we go down the line the next time that Duke faces that kind of adversity where a Cam Reddish or a Zion Williamson isn't able to play, or Jones or whoever, or Barrett. I mean, I'll be surprised to see what happens. I'll be really interested to see what happens with Duke when, if those issues ever come up again. So, but it'll be really interesting to see exactly how it all kind of plays out as we go through the rest of the college basketball season. Big thanks to you guys for your listener questions. Big thanks, of course, for joining the show each and every week and getting your press pass here on Press Row. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, review, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and, of course, you can find us on Spreaker.com and thepublichousemedia.org. You can always submit your questions as well on social media, Twitter and Instagram, at Press Row PHM. Find us on Facebook, Press Row Podcast by Public House Media, or email the show, PressRowPHM@gmail.com. You can also submit your listener questions throughout the show to me on Twitter. You can just hang out and chat with me if you ever want to, at Chris Heimel, C-H-R-I-S-H-E-I-M-A-L-L. Next week, we'll talk a little bit of college basketball as things are really starting to heat up. Just a couple of weeks to go. Really, just about a month and a half until we get to conference championship weekend. It's a fun time to be a sports fan, and we're really happy that you join us right here on Press Row, broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network.